Okay, we'll go ahead and call Safety and Public Properties to order. Roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Here.
Mr. Russo?
Here. Okay, item number one is approval of the minutes of the regular meeting on April 12, 2023.
Move to approve as submitted.
I'll second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, item number two is the approval of the minutes of, for the special meeting from April 17, 2023.
Move to approve as submitted.
I will second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, brings us to safety reports. Item number three is the jail report. Chief Tinelli?
Thank you. Just a few things to note on this one. Number of bookings actually pretty much stayed the same. 2% increase as 182 last month, 186 this month. The number of arrests actually declined by 28%. We had 72 last month and 56 this month. The number of housed or held prisoners for other departments increased by 19% with 110 last month and 130 this month. And unless there's other questions, that's my report.
Any questions?
No.
Okay. Thank you, Chief. Okay. Item number four is the traffic report for March and April. Chief Tinelli?
Thank you. If you remember last month, we didn't have a traffic report due to some software glitch, though this is actually a report for both March and April. As far as the traffic complaints, Southside Park at Bramble, we had a complaint of speeding and stop sign violations. Special attention for 2 weeks resulted in some warnings that were issued. At 28210 Aurora Road, complaint of noise. That complaint wasn't really clear as to what kind of noise it was. It was placed on special attention by patrol, however. Parkland Boulevard, speeding complaint. The speed trailer will be deployed there in the future. Arbordale Avenue, speeding complaint regarding high school traffic leaving in the afternoon. The speed radar sign will be displayed there through the end of the school year. And lastly, Walgreens, complaint of shortcutting private property was reported. Area was placed on special attention by patrol. We did a selective enforcement. That was on Timber Lane through March, or during March, the month of March. The results of that were 13 hours of enforcement with 5 speeding citations issued, 5 traffic warnings for speeding. As far as the 3 traffic logic radar signs, first one was deployed on Cromwell at Jefferson March 1st through April 30th. During that time, 44,161 cars were monitored. Average speed was 23, high was 62. And we determined that the high speed was actually from a vehicle which was trying to flee from an officer. So that was the rationale for that one. The second one was deployed on Emerald Ridge Parkway between March 1 and April 30th. 13,414 vehicles were monitored. Average speed 19, highest was 44. And the last radar sign was on Janet Drive, March 1 through April 30th. 11,638 vehicles monitored, average speed 26, highest is 48.
Great. Thank you, Chief. Any questions? Thank you. Okay, we have nothing under correspondence and brings us to engineering status update report.
Good evening. I have John's report. I can entertain any questions the committee has.
Any questions?
No.
All right. None. Then thank you. And then we have item number six is 34165 Aurora Road vacating old Aurora Road right away and 30-foot wide multi-purpose path easement.
Yes, as a part of the site plan approval of 34165 Aurora Road, which is the Wendy's site in 2019, Safety Public Properties approved the old the vacation of Old Aurora Road and the creation of a 30-foot wide easement, which is a section, I got it right here, and then it's highlighted in this blue section right here. So unfortunately, these two pieces of legislation were not created in time by City Council to approve for the site plan for 34165 Aurora Road. So the engineering department's requesting a two-piece of legislation be prepared. One is that legislation be prepared approving the vacation of the old Aurora Road and authorize the city to execute any paperwork in furtherance of the said right-of-way vacation. and a second piece of legislation, repair a 30-foot wide easement for the purpose of multi-purpose trailer in the area of the exact easement, which is in the blue here, and prepare all paperwork and have the mayor execute all paperwork in furtherance of this easement.
Any questions?
No.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll move to have legislation prepared approving the vacation of Old Aurora Road and to authorize City Council to execute any and all paperwork in furtherance of the right-of-way vacation.
Okay, I'll second that. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
And I'll move to have legislation prepared accepting a 30-foot wide easement for the purpose of a multi-purpose trail, and the easement being the same as that of the old vacated Old Aurora Road right-of-way, and authorizing the mayor to execute any and all paperwork in furtherance of said easement.
Okay, I will second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, brings us to item 6A, Solon Community Living Subdivision Temporary Right of Entry and Stormwater Discharge License. Mr. Dursick?
Yes. This afternoon or this morning, we had a meeting with the Solon Community Living administrative team. Before you is which will be drafted here shortly by Sarah, is a temporary right of entry and stormwater discharge license agreement granted to the Solon Community Living from the City of Solon. Typically, the engineering department doesn't allow any subdivision to start construction until all 30-party utilities have been submitted and have approval letters from the said utilities. Solon Community Living has submitted their applications and plan specifications to Cleveland Water, Ohio EPA, for their domestic water and sanitary sewer and all third-party utilities, but have not received their final approval. Solon Community Living has requested that engineering consider a temporary right of entry and stormwater discharge license agreement to allow them to install their stormwater pollution prevention plan, start grading the site, install storm sewers catch basins. This discharge point for the detention basin will be the existing storm sewer on a city property, so which is over here highlighted in the yellow area, which we have the existing. This is their consolidation plat, which has been temporarily approved by the county. Here is their stormwater and grading plan. The city has a storm sewer that runs through here. They'll be tying into the existing manhole right here, and this will give them the opportunity to start their grading. Solon Community Living will submit their lot consolidation easement plat to the once this agreement will terminate and sunset. Once Solon Community Living submits their lot consolidation easement plat to the city, it'll be recorded with the county. And again, I have attached it for your consideration with the what I gave you before. So I'm requesting a legislation before the Solon City Council under emergency, granting the temporary right of entry and stormwater discharge license to Solon Community Living so construction can begin as soon as possible.
Great. Any questions? Okay, hearing none.
I'll move to have legislation prepared forward to City Council under emergency so we can begin this project as soon as possible, granting a temporary right of entry and stormwater discharge license to Solon Community Living.
Okay, and I will second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, brings us to new item number 7, proposed addition to Solon's codified ordinances, electric vehicle charging stations.
Chief. Good evening. With electric vehicles gaining popularity, as often happens with new technology, the fire codes have not kept up with the new technology. And as a result of that, we have a perceived danger with having electric vehicle charging stations that don't have remote shutoffs to them. So we're proposing some legislation be city legislation to play kind of catch up in between the adoption of a national code or the Ohio code to require and add to the Solon codified ordinances in part 16 of the fire prevention code a clause under miscellaneous regulations that would require that electric vehicle charging stations not at private residences and not in duplexes but in places that the fire department is able to inspect. So that's apartment buildings, hotels, businesses, something larger than single-family homes, that there be a remote shutoff located between 20 and 100 feet from the vehicle charging station, that it be marked with a sign that the shut off be in an approved location so that it's easily noticeable to first responders and to patrons, and that this have a bollards in front of it, very much like a gasoline pump that has, so there's something to prevent somebody driving into it. The problem of not doing this is that we would need to go into a building, if it's accessible, find the electric circuit breaker box, then find the specific circuit breaker and shut it off. It just poses a number of problems. So very much like a fuel pump for gasoline and other fuels, we would propose that this be requested in legislation to add this to our fire prevention code.
Thank you. Any questions?
I have no problem with this, Chief. I think it's a great idea to do. The only question I have is that if we have businesses that do this and then there is something that's passed later on by the national model codes, is this going to be really expensive for them to implement to put the shutoff in? And then if there's a different code, as there would be for, like, as you mentioned, for fuel service stations, would it be, is this going to be a real financial difficulty for businesses if they have this?
So a number of communities in Ohio, we took this model legislation that's being used throughout the state. So we would hope that if it were adopted here in Ohio, it would have the identical language. If that's not the case, then there may be an expense associated with getting it to the right distance or something, or maybe with signage. But I anticipate that it would be something very similar to this.
Is this in effect now, this Ohio code?
Is the Ohio Fire Code in effect now?
No, but I mean, you said.
So there is no code provision in Ohio for anything having to do with electric vehicle charging stations now. The difficulty we have is that we're starting to see applications come in for putting them in. In fact, we have some in the city now. And we're trying to get ahead of this so that when they are installed, we're not forcing them to change them later. Because right now it's on the circuit breaker box inside the building.
Any other communities have anything in place right now?
Yes, a number of them in Ohio. Probably closest to us is Willoughby, and this is where we got the language from, was Willoughby.
Okay, great. And I would hope that if legislature takes this up, they would consult with the fire departments across the state and come with some, you know, rather than try to recreate something by legislators that have no idea what they're putting together.
I would be very surprised if they mandated a shutoff that would be closer than 20 feet or further than 100 feet. So we tried to kind of look to place something that could be on a post separately or could be on the side of a building that's even 100 feet away that someone could access and shut off. So.
Right.
Well, yeah, I'm fine with this. I just want to make sure, first of all, I want to be safe, but I want to make sure it's not going to be something that someone spends several thousand dollars putting in and then the state comes in and makes them do it a different way, you know, a year from now.
I understand the concern. Again, I don't know that the distance would be different, so I can't imagine that it would be different.
No. Right. And I'd rather get something in place now than wait.
I agree, and I think we, if the chief's recommending this, I think it's acceptable.
Okay. Well, I'll entertain a motion.
So I'll move to have legislation prepared, adding the to Part 16 of the Codified Ordinances, Chapter 1660, Miscellaneous Regulations, the emergency shutoff valve accessible to the public and first responders, and have legislation prepared.
Okay, I'll second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Polinas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, item number 8, disposal of miscellaneous park and recreation equipment and accessories. Mr. Parker.
Before you is a list of equipment that the Recreation Department is seeking authority to dispose of. This property and equipment has been determined to be unneeded, obsolete, or unfit for department purposes. Again, there's a list attached. Not all of it will necessarily be replaced. It'll be replaced as necessary, either from our approved budget or the capital improvement plan.
Any questions? Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
Move to have legislation prepared. Authorizing disposal of the items via gov deals as an emergency and on first reading of council.
Okay, I'll second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Polinas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, item number nine, ambulance manufacturer from Horton Emergency Vehicles using our supplied chassis. Chief Vedder.
Thank you. You may recall that at a previous meeting, we had purchased or agreed to purchase, enter into an agreement to purchase an ambulance complete. And you may recall I came back to you and said that we're having difficulty in getting the chassis for that to be built. And we ordered a chassis separately. This is now the legislation to do the actual build of the ambulance on the chassis we're providing. Total for this under state term schedule would be $233,328.
Thank you. Any questions?
No.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll move to have legislation prepared under emergency so we can have the ambulance built as soon as possible in the amount of $233,328 per the Ohio State term schedule for the fire department and on first reading at council.
Okay, I will second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, brings us item number 10, change order for the community center caulking replacement and EFS repair contract 2023-17.
Yes, the Public Works Division is requesting a change order for the community center caulking replacement and EFS repairs project contract 2023-17 in the amount of $16,693.69 and a time extension of 57 days. When we were doing our walkthrough and our pre-construction for the project, we identified several areas that were in need of paint. Like there's a big beam across the back by the pool area, some steel rods that hold up some wood lattices, and some metal doors that needed some paint. So that was the foundation for this change order. So the Public Works is requesting they have legislation prepared approving a change order modification submitted by Johnson Lau Construction LLC through the Aqualis Group contract COG-2118 GCO2-D for caulking replacement EFIS repairs of community center building to include additional painting as detailed in the attachment in the amount of $16,693.69. Furthermore, I'm asking this legislation contain emergency clause to secure materials and start construction as weather makes it possible. And if this change order is approved, it would revise the contract to $184,138.82 and extend the substantial completion date to July 31st, 2023.
Okay, any questions? Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
Move to have legislation prepared under emergency so we can get these repairs completed as soon as possible, revising the contract in the amount of $184,138.82 and extending the substantial completion date to July 31, 2023, and the change order itself is $16,693.69.
Okay, I'll second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, item number 11, community center concrete repair around sculpture. Mr. Parker.
So as you recall, I've previously been in front of council to request the removal and relocation of the sculpture in front of the community center in an effort to repair the walkway that is there. We had since met with the artist and discussed different options and ultimately decided that we'd like to keep the sculpture in place. We have taken advantage of the time between then and now to get a better idea of the construction or how the sculpture was installed and have what we feel is a more accurate or an accurate quote for the concrete work, taking into consideration the fact that we do want to leave the sculpture in its place. So that quote is attached. We had completed some core drilling to determine the depth of the concrete, which helped the vendor determine what exactly is needed to be done, again, to repair the concrete while still maintaining the structure in place. So we think we've thoroughly investigated this matter, and our priority is repairing the concrete walkway in front of the center. Right. So we're requesting to leave the sculpture in place. I believe this will require rescinding a previous ordinance that authorized the removal of that sculpture. But this item was tabled previously.
Okay. Any questions?
I think we're just have this on the agenda, and I think the rescission will have to happen at council, I believe. I would imagine, because we don't have that on our.
I believe so, yes.
Would you want to make that part of the motion on this to rescind the other?
Yep, well, let's do that.
I'll move that we have.
Before, I've got one question, Mr. Dursick.
The only thing that I would add here is I know there has been discussion of potentially, there's currently parking spots on the other side of the drive that I think the senior center uses, and I'm not sure if they were considering using those as handicap ADA spots. If they do wish to consider to switch those to ADA spots, the way that concrete is currently in is not ADA compliant. So there's not enough room to get around the sculpture right now, and I don't know if the ramps meet the ADA requirements, so that may want to be a consideration in moving forward.
Okay, so they're looking, who's looking to add ADA spots?
I'm not aware of the need to add any ADA spots.
Okay.
And I can appreciate that perhaps it's been discussed with Jill Frankel, Director of Senior Services, but my understanding is that the expansion of the parking lot resolves a lot of those issues. My biggest concern is that the continued discussion of this matter is just going to prolong the repair.
Right, right. And the $4,800 that's quoted here, is that, what's that for?
That's repairing the concrete and leaving the statue in place.
Okay.
Now, there's, you know, some contingencies depending on what they get into. We did made our best effort to determine what's underneath the sculpture, but, you know, we drilled down 16 inches and believe we got through one slab of concrete.
Okay.
Below that, we're not sure what's there.
Gotcha.
But the vendor, who has done lots of concrete work in the city, feels that they should be able to remove that and then put the new course of concrete on top to level out that surface that's now nature stone.
Gotcha.
Without too much concern what's below the 16 inches.
Gotcha. Okay. And we're getting rid of the nature stone.
Excuse me?
It's going to be all concrete. We're getting rid of.
Yes. The purpose is to get rid of the nature stone.
Okay. Great. All right.
I'll move to have legislation prepared, first rescinding the inconsistent ordinance that authorized removal of the sculpture, as well as approval of a $4,800 proposal from Scott's Services LLC for the work on the concrete under emergency, and forwarded to council.
I'll second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Colonis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Okay, just added to the agenda, there was a couple of questions I had asked Mr. Parker. I know that last fall, the classes at the rec center, they did away with the fees for that in anticipation of the increase in dues. And I wanted to find out when we were going to increase the dues, seeing that I think that change was made in October. And Mr. Parker, I believe you said the new fee schedule will be going in place June 1st?
That's correct. It's our intention to raise fees June 1st. These fees have been posted at the center to give members forewarning of the change. Over the course of our 20-year history at the center, fees have been raised five times. This would be the fifth. Actually, four times. Well, we've had four prices, excuse me. They've been raised three times. This would be the fourth.
Okay. Great. And then also, is there going to be a change to the cost for a credit if somebody takes out a six-month membership and decides that they want to terminate it after a month, 2 months, 3 months?
Well, we are discussing with a number, you know, internally, as well as with the finance department, our refund policy.
Right.
And the purpose is just to make sure that we're not, you know, that we're being prudent with the city's money and not, you know, because we have credit card fees that we get charged. So if they purchase.
Right. Yeah. Like a processing fee.
We just want to make sure that our refund policy is appropriate and takes, you know, our interests into account.
Right. Yeah, because I think you were, what, charging $2 before?
Historically, it's a $3 service fee. It's just a flat fee no matter what.
And I think other communities charge much more than that.
Excuse me?
Other communities charge much more than that.
I'm not familiar with what other communities charge. Sometimes they add an additional fee when people are paying with credit. I don't know that that's what we'll do.
All right.
I think it's a percentage. Sometimes they charge a
Well, I know credit cards, it's a percentage, and usually it's tied to the average ticket charge for your credit card charge.
I think it's usually 3 or 4% on the whatever the $445 for a full membership would be 3%, 3.5%.
So, okay. Just want to make sure that got squared away. And then a situation came up with AEDs up at the rec center, or not the rec center, but the community park. I know we have a number of different age groups playing up at the park, not only that, plus spectators. And so just if we could just go over where the AED is located and identifying the process you go to make sure that's fully charged. One of the players in the league that I play in, asked me about this because they were participating in a game down in Canton at the old Thurman Munson Stadium, and a player, collapsed. They had an AED on site there, but it wasn't fully charged. So fortunately, somebody was able to do CPR and chest compressions, and that was sufficient to save the gentleman. So, but I just want to make sure, Rich, if you can just go over that as well.
Sure. We have a total of 4 AEDs throughout Parks and Rec property, and one of those is at the park. It is located inside the log cabin, which is one of our service buildings at the park. The log cabin is open generally when we have activity at the park, but it isn't open 24/7. Does get secured when staff leave for the day. The AED, currently all of our AEDs at the Parks and Rec Department are leased through Cintas, who also provides our first aid equipment throughout the city, I believe. As a part of this service, they, not only do we check it on a regular basis, but they also, as part of that service, check it monthly.
Right.
And there's a service checklist on the side of the AED box that shows when it was serviced. So making sure that it is fully charged, has up-to-date pads that aren't expired, that's all part of the service that Cintas provides for the leasing of that AED. I will say the topic of whether or not to have an AED outside has been discussed internally just recently. And at that time, we decided not to keep an AED outside for a number of reasons, vandalism, et cetera. However, I am aware that there is a House Bill 47, that's being discussed. That would require Parks and Recs departments to have AEDs at their ball fields. So I feel that the requirement to have a public AED that is, outside and available at all times is something that's going to happen eventually. So we've been rigorously looking for good alternatives. Again, waterproof case, some sort of alarm that would alert people if it's been pulled out, that sort of thing. Chief Vetter has been invaluable. He's provided some leads on that information. So I imagine in the near future we'll have something outside, with signage that directs people to where it's at and so forth.
Great. Thank you. And then the last item concerning the bocce ball courts. I know we had a conversation, and were you able to get a hold of Carl Panetti?
No, I haven't talked to Carl yet. I have his information. We'll be speaking with him.
Okay.
I understand he's reached out to a couple of individuals. I did have a chance to meet with the Italian Club last fall. And at that time, we committed to, carrying the lion's brunt of the burden of maintaining those, because the Italian Club installed them and has put forth great effort in maintaining them up to this point. And we certainly appreciate that. But we want to make sure that it's part of our park property and something that we want to maintain. So there is the potential, as part of the master plan, as has been discussed, to relocate those.
Right.
And I think when they're relocated, a lot of our experiences that we've had now.
Right.
Will be factored into the design of the new bocce. I mean, not only shade, et cetera, but, you know, perhaps some sort of fencing to keep people who aren't using it appropriately off of it.
Right.
Because just like a baseball field or turf field, which is so valuable, you don't need people getting on it and damaging it.
Right.
So.
No, appreciate that. And Chief Tonelli and I will make sure we, if you don't get a chance to talk to Carl, we'll talk to him to make sure if he has issues to come see you.
We'd be happy to keep those in pristine condition.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. I have nothing else this evening. Anything else? I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
To adjourn.
Second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Pelunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes. Meeting adjourned. Thank you, everybody.